Hare Krishna, dear friends. Welcome to the 8th episode of the Srimad Bhagavatam. And we start with a short Jaya Radha Madhava. Jaya Radha Madhava. One second. Jaya Radha Madhava, Jaya Kunja Bihari, Jaya Radha Madhava, Jaya Kunja Bihari, Jaya Gopi Jana Vallabha, Jaya Giri Varadhari. Jaya Giri Varadhari, Jaya Gopi Jana Vallabha, Jaya Giri Varadhari, Jaya Giri Varadhari, Yashoda Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana. Yashoda Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana Jamuna Tira Vanachari Jamuna Tira Vanachari Jaya Radha Madhava Jaya Kunja Bihari Jaya Radha Madhava Jaya Kunja Bihari. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam Namaskritya Narang Chaiva Narottamam. Devim Sarasvatim Vyasam Tato Jayam Udhirayat Nashtaprayeshva Vatreshu Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya Bhagavatyutama Shloke Bhaktya Bhavati Naishtiki. So welcome, dear friends, to another session of reading the daily Srimad Bhagavatam. We are in the 11th canto, 8th chapter, the story of Pingala, and we are at the 6th shloka today. So it goes like Samriddha kamohinova narayano paro munihi natsupeta na shusheta surit bir iva sagaraha. And I have my glasses, so then I can read better. The translation is, during the rainy season, the swollen rivers rush into the ocean, and during the dry summer, the rivers, now shallow, severely reduce the supply of water, yet the ocean does not swell up during the rainy season, nor does it dry up in the hot summer. In the same way, a saintly devotee who has accepted the Supreme Personality of Godhead as the goal of life sometimes will receive by providence great material opulence, and sometimes he will find himself materially destitute. However, such a devotee of the Lord does not rejoice in a flourishing condition, nor is he morose when poverty-stricken. Purport. A sincere devotee of the Lord is always eager to meet the Lord and render him transcendental service. He wants to remain fixed as an atom at the lotus feet of the Lord, because Lord Krishna, or Narayan, is the reservoir of all pleasure. He rejoices when experiencing pure Krishna consciousness and is morose when Krishna is not present in his mind. In his dealings with the material world, a devotee cannot be disturbed by ordinary materialistic people who sometimes insult him and accuse him of neglecting material sense gratification. Just as the ocean cannot be disturbed by the innumerable rivers that enter into it. Sometimes lusty women approach a pure devotee, and sometimes speculative philosophers try to argue against the personality of Godhead, but with all such ordinary people, a pure devotee is detached and undisturbed in his blissful Krishna consciousness. Again the verse. During the rainy season, the swollen rivers rush into the ocean, and during the dry summer, the rivers, now shallow, severely reduce their supply of water. Yet the ocean does not swell up during the rainy season, nor does it dry up in the hot summer. In the same way, a saintly devotee who has accepted the Supreme Personality of Godhead as the goal of his life sometimes will receive by providence great material opulence, and sometimes he will find himself materially destitute. However, such a devotee of the Lord does not rejoice in a flourishing condition, nor is he morose when poverty-stricken. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshu Unmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. So, yes, this is again very interesting, Hare Krishna. And again, the example of the ocean is further described here. And it is said that from a material point of view, a serious devotee is not rejoicing when he is experiencing a lot of material opulence. And in the same way, the devotee is not morose when he might be, materially speaking, in a very sad condition. In both situations, a devotee, an advanced Vaishnava, he is detached. There is also a verse in the Srimad Bhagavad Gita. Dukeshvanutvignamanaha sukeshu vigatas priyaha vitaraga bhaya krodha stita dia munya uchyate. There it is said that a person who is not affected or jubilant when enjoying a lot of material happiness, and who is not depressed when there is suffering, and who is freed from vita raga bhaya krodha, who is free from attachment, fear, and attachment, bhaya, and vita raga bhaya krodha, and of who is freed of krodha, that means anger. This person, it is said in Bhagavad Gita, is known to be a yogi with a steadfast mind. So that is exactly the position of an advanced Vaishnava. He is only interested in engaging himself in the loving devotional service of the Lord. That is his source of feeling pleasure. When he is fixed in the devotional service of the Lord, when he feels, yes, I am engaged in the service of the Lord, so everything is fine. That is the situation where he feels satisfied, where he feels pleasure. And even if materially speaking, he is in a sad condition, that he is not bothered by that. And in the same way, maybe he has just win in the lottery and he gets $1 million. Then from the material point of view, an advanced Vaishnava, he is not jubilant. Oh, I have won $1 million dollars. No. He knows that this $100 million, at one point it comes, and maybe 1 week later it will disappear again. So this, I think all of us, we have experienced that material happiness or luck may come very easily, but then it can also go very easily. Interesting, I just said the word luck, and there is a connection between the European languages and the Sanskrit language. So we know that there is the goddess of fortune, Mother Lakshmi, and there is the word luck. We can also find it in English. Luck means fortune. So, and it is said that the goddess of fortune here in the material world is known as, I think her name is Chanchala, unsteady, very unsteady. Because when people try to enjoy fortune in this material world, without Narayan, when people here, when conditioned souls here in the material world try to enjoy Lakshmi Devi without Narayan, then Lakshmi Devi will be at one point be the cause of distress, because Lakshmi Devi is only there where Narayan, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, is. As we know from the Vedic scripture, Mother Lakshmi is a very, she is the inner energy of the Lord. She is an expansion of Srimati Radharani, and she cannot have any other spouse or husband or lover than Lord Sri Krishna or Narayan. She would never go to another place. There was a demon called Ravana. Once he, he captivated once Mother Sita and tried to enjoy Mother Sita, who is the eternal consort of Sri Ramachandra. He tried to enjoy Mother Sita independently. Hitchhiked. He hitchhiked her with very dubious methods and brought her to his kingdom called Lanka, Sri Lanka, where he had a golden city, it is said. He had a very opulent city there with all opulences. He was very, very rich, and he was also very handsome, Ravana, and he lived in a very beautiful palace with all kinds of facilities for sense gratification. So then he brought Mother Sita to his palace, against her will, of course, but he tried to convince her that, well, look, your former husband, so he said, Ramachandra, you lived with him in the forest in a very austere condition. You lived in a bamboo hut and you have no real dress, no ornaments and no good food, just, you know, berries from the forest and some roots. But here I can offer you everything you want for your sense gratification, and I am also very handsome. So why don't you become my wife and reject this ordinary human being called Ram? So, but Mother Sita, she was disgusted. She only felt disgust for Ravana, and she said, "I will never become your wife. I will always be the eternal consort of Lord Rama." So then Ravana, he said, "I give you 360 days and you can change your mind, and I hope during this time you have decided to become my wife, so that I also can enjoy with you conjugal love. But if you decide against this proposal, then I will eat you up. I will devour you." So we have to know that Ravana was a Rakshasa. He was able to eat human beings. So very, very very sympathetic guy. Suppose you are married with a man who sometimes eats human being, who is a cannibal. So the result was that Lord Ramachandra, he somehow, with the help of his monkey army and especially with the help of Hanuman, he could find Mother Sita. He could understand where Mother Sita was captured. That was in this golden city of the island Lanka. And with an army of monkeys and bears, he built a bridge from South India to Lanka. And in a very ghastly war, he destroyed the whole city and the whole dynasty, practically, of Ravana, this demon. So all the family members, or not all, but many family members and advisors, they requested Ravana, this demon, to please give this woman back to Lord Rama, who is the actual husband. Give that lady back to him, otherwise you will be destroyed. And we too, and the whole city. But Ravana, he was so demoniac and so attached to sense gratification and so proud that he did not listen to his advisors. And in this way, he signed his own destruction. So this is a good example that whenever we try to enjoy happiness, material happiness and fortune, without the consciousness that everything belongs to Lord Krishna, all fortune, all opulences, this is Lord Krishna, the supreme possessor, then at one point we will only suffer. We will suffer and go the path of our own destruction. So therefore, a devotee of the Lord, knowing this, he understands that there is no use of enjoying the material energy without Krishna. So only when we use the material energy, the opulence, the fortune, when we engage all that in the loving service of the Lord, then it reveals this so-called material energy, suddenly reveals its spiritual nature, it becomes spiritualized. So therefore, a devotee of the Lord that is not interested in enjoying material happiness, and he is also not agitated or bothered when he is poverty stricken. So there are a lot of examples also in the Vedic scriptures of very exalted devotees who were very poor materially speaking, but inside they were the most richest persons. There was one devotee of Lord Chaitanya called Kulavecha Sridhar. He was selling banana leaves in India. I don't know, maybe today even still in some villages, but let's say 50 years ago, when I was in India the first time about 27 years ago, you took a meal that was placed on a banana leaf, that was like a plate, and when you were done, you could just throw away that banana leaf at some place, and then the cows came and ate these banana leaves. Today, unfortunately, there is so much plastic cups, so people throw away the plastic cups, and then the cows, they eat all this plastic and get severely diseased. So this Kulavecha Sridhar, he was selling these banana leaves for some very few price, and he was very, very poor, but he was a very exalted devotee of Lord Chaitanya. And even although he had such a short income, he gave 50% for the worship of Mother Ganga. So yeah, this is one of many, many examples. And yeah, to bring this reading to an end, we should just try to experience pleasure in the execution of devotional service and find our pleasure there, instead of hankering for material happiness. And we should also not be too much disturbed when we are affected by inconveniences. So this is the message we get today from the pages of the Srimad Bhagavatam. If there are some questions, I see here are some comments. You can write some comments or questions if you have experienced something similar. Otherwise, we see us tomorrow morning, German time, to the daily Bhagavatam mirror. Hare Krishna. Thank you for listening and watching. Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Jai.